It's wonderful to be here, and I want to talk to you about a very small subject and a very large subject. I want to talk about everything and about nothing. I want to talk about the universe and how we understand the universe at this moment. And I should give a warning, I'm a theorist. My world is the world of formulas, of equations, and so we need some very deep philosophers to put this in the right context, and no better than Fock and Sucker. As they put it very well, does it also work in theory? And because the universe works, there's nothing that we have to do. It just keeps on running, but can we understand it? And what is the language that we need to understand it? There's a beautiful image, goes back to the 17th century, to Galileo, who said it's the book of nature that we try to read. That's what science is about, understanding that book. And he said if you want to understand that book, you have to learn the language that he speaks. And for him, the language was the language of geometry, of formulas, of equations. And I think that's still very much the idea. If you go far away from our everyday experience to the world of the very small particles, of the large structures, we somehow have to rely on other methods. And even somebody who is a more recent hero of, I guess, many of you, Richard Feynman, who people might think is not really a formal person, he still said that if you really want to understand the beauty of nature, the deepest beauty of nature, you have to appreciate the language that he speaks in. And for him, that language was mathematics. Now, physicists are also very arrogant, and so he also had this beautiful statement, if mathematics disappeared today, physics would be set back exactly 1 week. Now, I always thought, well, this is a very clever remark, until I met a mathematician who had the perfect answer to that. That was the week that God created the world. So I would say 2-to-1, math to physics, and that's the spirit I want to continue. Now, the world I'm going to talk about is something which is very far removed from your everyday experience, as I said. I want to talk about the very large, the cosmos, which is governed by the world of relativity theory, very strange, and the very small elementary particles that are governed by the laws of quantum mechanics, perhaps even stranger. Well, if you go to the very large, of course, you enter the world of Einstein. And Einstein is his famous theory of relativity, and it's an absolutely beautiful theory. There's not a single physicist who doesn't believe this is one of the most beautiful things ever found. And it has, because it goes back to the very foundations in which we basically start thinking about the world, which is geometry. Einstein basically said that the geometry of space and time, like the floor I'm kind of walking on, it's not a rigid stage, it's like flexible, it can be curved, and anything that exists, anything that has energy, anything that has mass, will curve your surrounding. And that curvature of space and time, that's what gravity is. And he had this wonderful experience that he was the first person to discover that actually the universe itself was alive. It could grow, it does grow, it expands, and so since it has a future, it had a past, you can go back in time, and you find that there was a moment, the Big Bang, in which the whole story started. A beautiful piece of theory, but it's really something that belongs to the world of the very large. On the other hand, we have the very small. That's the world of quantum physics. And there's a famous physics professor that taught me, Martinus Veldman, who won the Nobel Prize, once asked the television, what do particle physics, what is it about? He said, you have two particles, and you smash them together, and big bang, and that's it. A lot of garbage. It's a picture like you see here. That's what's being produced. So it doesn't look like anything nice or beautiful or elegant. And you could ask, is there a way to understand this? Are we human beings capable of understanding the very small? And there was a time when we thought we could not. We thought that the world was just like a black box. If you look at the ideas of particle physics, you see this idea that the world can be understood. And that is Einstein's perhaps most famous saying, that the great wonder of nature is that the human mind can actually understand it. People thought perhaps the world at the very tiny is like a black box. Like many of you think about your computer or your phone, it's not something that you would care to take apart. Something comes in, something comes out, and that's it. Now, this was what people thought in the 60s. They said we should have a holistic approach. Perhaps not an accident that theory was living in the surrounding of Berkeley, which is in some sense kind of a hippie way of looking at nature. But something remarkable happened. In the early 70s, it turned out that the box could be opened, and so to say, there is a very tiny formula in this box. And if you look at the formula here, you see it. It's the formula of the standard model. It's the way I write it. It's a very succinct way to write it. But this formula determines everything around us. Everything here in the room can, in principle, be computed using this formula. And you can lecture to, say, a mathematician, and he will not understand a word what you're describing, but he will recognize the symbols. The symbols that you see here are beautiful, elegant symbols. They talk about symmetry. They talk about geometry. It's a beautiful story hidden inside these elementary particles. Now, of course, it's not the way you learn it in a physics course. There you learn it like this. And that's a lot of work to understand all the details. But you know, on the other hand, you can put it on a t-shirt. The elementary particles, you can put them on a t-shirt, and that's the story. It's very simple. Of course, this is a remarkable achievement, that basically all the garbage you see around us can be reduced to something that you can put on a t-shirt. Now, if you look at these particles, you see that the way we have able to understand them is that we think, in some sense, not of single events, but what physicists call the sum over histories. All possible things that the particles can do, we compute them, and we compute them with amazing accuracy. One in a millionth of a millionth accuracy, which is basically the width of a hair compared to the distance of the Earth to the Moon. The most amazing accuracy is achieved in the world which is most foreign to us. And if you look at these elementary particles and you see before them, there are two emotions. The first emotion is, what is it a beautiful story, what an elegant world we live in. And the second story is, and that was famously said by a physicist, was one of these particles was discovered, who ordered this? Why are there three colors of quarks, six flavors, three families? Why these masses? Why these structures? Is there something, a puzzle that can be solved? And people are looking at the puzzle, and for instance, if you rearrange these particles a slightly different way, you see certainly certain structures appearing. It's like nature is giving us tiny hints that there is an even nicer story hidden behind all the details that we have found. And of course, this is what rings, in some sense, the emotions in a physicist like me. You want to discover the secrecies of nature. And there's a few other hints. For instance, recent years, people have found that there's lots and lots of matter in the universe that's dark. Here you see a picture of it, but that's because, basically, computer animation, you can make this bluish light. The bluish light is invisible to the human eye. But there's lots of matter in the universe, roughly 6 to 7 times the amount of usual matter, the matter hidden in planets, in stars, in us, that's out there. And nobody knows what it's made of. But it's there, we want to understand. And there's another hint. If you look at the forces of nature, you say they are very different. There are forces, electromagnetism, the forces that hold together the nucleus. There's gravity, I'll say a word about it in a moment. And the wonderful thing is, if you go to higher and higher energies and smaller distances, all these forces seem to unify. It's sometimes said that the main urge of a human being is to unify. That's why we fall in love. See? It's kind of, we want to make everything together. And I think actually physicists have that same kind of frustration. They want to unify all the forces of nature. It looks like nature wants it also. There are strong suggestions that at very small distances, everything becomes essentially the same. And that means that this is even the story will be much more bizarre. That means that even at the smallest distances, space and time itself will stop being there. It's like the floor on which I'm walking is not only flexible, it's not only made of rubber, but it's like oscillating or something. And one way to think about it, and this is something that Planck, the physicist, already at the year 1900 understood, that in some sense nature is like a digital photograph. If you look in the picture and you look closer and closer and closer, at some point you see little pixels. And it looks like that in the nature we have pixels too, extremely small and tiny, much, much, much smaller than we can now look with our microscopes, say our particle accelerators, but there is some kind of a graininess in nature. So for instance, philosophers have been speculating for ages of the infinitesimally small and the infinitely large, but we know that it's not necessary. There's a smaller scale in the world where basically space and time disappear, and there's a smallest and a largest scale, the scale which is basically the biggest size that we can look in the present universe. And to go from the left to the right in this small pic is only 60 steps of 10. I think it's an amazing achievement of science that we have reduced our knowledge to this simple picture. And you know what is the most amazing thing is that right in the middle is the scale of human life. It's the size of a human cell. So if you want to visualize the universe, you can think of, take a small scale model of the universe, take the whole universe, make it as small as a bacterium, and then a little bacterium inside this original bacterium, that is the smallest distance that we have in nature. Now, you might ask, why is the universe so extremely large, for instance? That's a very good question, and that's something that you should be able to answer at any birthday party, and you do a little experiment, I have it here. So you take a little magnet, and you have two magnets, and now what's happening? You see one magnet is pulling on the other magnet, but it wants to go up, but the Earth is pulling back. It's gravity. I have a little magnet, the whole Earth on the other side, and you see what happens. I win. The magnetic force is stronger than the whole gravity of the full Earth. That means that gravity is extremely weak force. If you would like to kind of make these very small scales in which gravity is operating, you would need an accelerator as much as large as a galaxy. So in some sense, we understand, or at least we can measure, we can just show it to everybody, why the universe is so extremely large. Because basically gravity is extremely weak. You need many big objects to build a universe. Now, if you go to the smaller scales, there's another important question that's going on. How can the smaller structures influence the larger structure? And I start with a very simple question. A question one raised, if you think about it, elementary particles, they are all the same. Why? And there's a famous story by physics professor John Wheeler. He phoned his graduate student, Richard Feynman, in the middle of the night and said, I know why all the electrons are exactly the same, because there's only one particle in the whole universe. Now, he called in the middle of the night, I think, on Saturday, so you have to be very careful if your advisor calls you at that time. But this was the story. You have the single particle, and usually particles go up in time. But suppose that you could go back in time, and up and back again. Now, many copies of you could go back in time and go sit here in the front row. You have many, many copies. So if you look at a certain time, you would see many, many copies of these particles. And they would be all the same. They would be exactly the same property because it's the same particle. Feynman said it was a crazy idea, but now these diagrams are called Feynman diagrams, so he was very careful to use them. And you know, even crazier things can happen. If you have a particle, it can, for instance, split for a brief time into two other particles. And if it does so very fast, before you can notice it, then it's allowed. I like to joke that in some sense the laws of physics are very much like the laws in the Netherlands. You know, you can do everything that's possible if you do it fast enough before it gets detected. And in fact, even a stranger thing can happen. Out of nothing, two particles can appear, live for a very short time, and disappear again. Another way to think about it, you can have a particle can go up in time and down in time, up and down. And this is not some crazy esoteric phenomena. This happens right here in this hall, everywhere. What you think of as empty space actually is filled with these processes. Here's my own computer animation, how I think of the vacuum, empty space. It's like a boiling pot where you see particles appearing and disappearing again. It's a fact that has been measured, first time in a laboratory by Dutch physicist Casimir. But in fact, it's now measured in a grand scale in the universe. You see, the ultimate conclusion is, through these funny laws of the very small, empty space becomes alive. If you take a piece of empty space, it's boiling with these particles. And these particles have energy, and energy gets translated into mass. That was Einstein's famous saying. So what happens, empty space itself starts to move. And we can measure how much energy is there in empty space. And in fact, if there's energy in empty space, it will do something amazing, it will expand. And now you can see you have a disaster. Because if it expands, it creates more empty space that gets filled with energy that pushes even harder. So right now, we look at the universe and we see it's like a car on which somebody put in the gas. It starts to accelerate and accelerate and accelerate, and our universe is expanding even faster and faster because of this dark energy. And you can measure it very precisely. Right now, We can measure this because of diagrams like this. This perhaps you've seen. This is a baby picture of the universe. This is how the universe looked when it was 300,000 years old. Very, 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 very tiny. It's now 13.7 billion years. And you see this kind of spots. And these spots are the very, very, very first oscillations in the universe that in the end will grow, and they will grow to form all the structure that we see around. And somebody is very happy with this picture. Perhaps we notice here there are two letters here, SH, which is Stephen Hawking. And once you've seen it, you can't no longer not see it anymore. It's there. The picture is signed. And it's these fluctuations, random or not, perhaps there was a creator, lead to everything that we see around. And by measuring these data very precisely, we basically have done something amazing. Namely, we have, so to say, took the weight of the universe. We have seen what is the full energy content in the universe, what is the universe made of. And the results are shocking. Because everything that we knew, the stars, the planets, you and me, anything you can learn in all the textbooks, in all the physics libraries in the world, accounts only for 4% of the energy in the universe. The rest is made out of this dark matter, roughly 1/4, and 3/4 of the universe is made out of this dark energy, just sitting there in the empty space. Fancy words for great unknowns. So there's something marvelous in cosmology that we know exactly what we don't know. 96% we don't know. And often I go to people and ask, you know, what is your percentage that you don't know? Can you put a number to it? And we can, and that's amazing consequence, because this tells us also what the future of the universe will be. The future of the universe will be very dark, literally. It will expand. It will create more of this empty space that will push harder and harder and harder. In the end, we'll be basically on our own. There will only our galaxy will be there. It will burn out. And then it's like you bought a videotape, and you know it's infinitely long. There's a famous saying of Woody Allen that infinity is a very long time, particularly towards the end. And that's basically what's happening. This universe will expand and extend, and it will be just be black forever. But it's a very brief time, so to say, compared to eternity, basically infinitesimally small time, and which is this time right now that we are living, where the universe is, say, maximally interesting. And I think that's a very important knowledge. If you see of these old maps that the old explorers made, they had a lot of empty space, but they didn't give it a name. What they put a lot of these sea monsters there. So 96% was filled with sea monsters. And I think what we are now trying to do is kind of put these sea monsters, and if you look very good, see the upper left hand, a small little boat. And I often think, well, that's what science is. It's a little boat that kind of is in this big ocean of unknown and kind of trying to explore what is our universe, the unknown universe. Thank you very much.